Okay, hello and welcome back. I hope you have seen my first two video on Introduction to Economics, where I explained the difference between economic activity and non-economic activity. And we have also gone through four definitions of economics. That was wealth definition given by Adam Smith, welfare definition given by Alfred Marshall, scarcity definition given by Robinson, and the growth definition that was given by Professor Samuelson, and their some features and its criticism. In this video, I'm going to help you out to understand the second chapter, that is economy and its entity. And as you can see, the title of this chapter is economy and entity. So therefore, it become very important for us to first understand what actually the word economy and what actually the word entities mean here. So for this, I will take you to my first slide that will help you to understand the meaning of the word economy, right? So I'll first read the first point that will explain what actually the economy, or what is the definition of economy, and then I will explain this with help of a small example. You can see the first point: an economy is defined as a system comprising of institution and organization that help people to get their living directly or indirectly satisfying their wants. So this is what actually the general definition of the word economy is. Many a time we hear people talking about or using the words like Indian economy, US economy, European economy, Australian economy. We always find, even in the television also, we find the anchors using these type of word. The point is, what do actually they mean by saying Indian economy or Australian economy? So it is nothing but they mean the group of institution, or I may say the various institution or organization that work in their own respect and help the economy to run. So let us take an example to understand this in a better way. You can see here in the first point, the example is taken like this, where I have written that example. Say suppose a system comprising of factory and firm, shop, road, railway, school, colleges and hospitals. So I've taken a very few examples of actually what economy comprises of, but still this will be very helpful for us to understand what actually the word economy means. Okay, so I'll start from this, that is the hospital. So what happened when we fall sick, we go to hospital, and there we find it is the doctors and nurses who are there, who help the hospitals to run, and they treat the patient. The point is, the basic point is, the nurses and the doctors, they get their living from the hospitals. They earn their living from the hospital. They work there, they earn the money from there, and that is how they run their life, and they satisfy their demand. So, but here again, if we go a little back into this topic, then the point is, none of us can be a doctor, or none of us can be nurses, unless and until we have a proper education. So therefore, the another important organization or institution is school and colleges. So these are the organization or institution that directly or indirectly helps the people to earn their life. The teachers, the school staff, those who are working in the school, they get their earning, they get their living from the salary that they generate from these institutions like school and colleges. Similarly, the goods that we demand in the market, those goods are produced in farms and factory. But these goods, when they are produced in farms and factory, they cannot brought to a shop or to the retail shop unless and until there is a transport facility like road and railway. So the point is, each and every institution is important in an economy, and they are playing their role in a definite manner to help the economy to run smoothly. So basically, what actually an economy is, I hope now you can get an idea what actually I want to explain, that what is economy. So economy is nothing but it is a system that consists of all such institutions that are playing their own role and helping the economy to run in a smooth manner. One way or other, they are helping the people to earn their livelihood. This is what actually the word economy means. And when we are talking about Indian economy, then you can bring these examples into the definition of Indian economics and Indian economy, and you can find out what actually Indian economy is. Okay, so this is the general definition of the word economy, and we'll go for some more topic where you can see that some people are there or some economists are there who define economy a little bit differently. They say that economy can be defined as a system of cooperation, or some are there who are telling that economy is defined as a system of mutual exchange. So both are actually a very relevant topic to define what is economy. So for explaining you what is system of cooperation, I would like to go for my next slide that will help you to understand why we say that economy can also be defined as a system of cooperation. I hope you can see here that is what actually, let me first read the first point and then I will explain what is actually a system of cooperation among producer mean. It is written, in the process of providing living to the people, various goods and services are produced in an economy in order to satisfy human want. Goods and services are produced by mutual cooperation of people. This is the most important point to define an economy. As you can see here, a small picture, you can find here that this picture explains system of cooperation among the people in our country or among the people in any economy of the world. So let us take one example. Suppose, imagine that this is a dairy farm where milk is produced. The milk that is produced here in dairy farm is exported by using a shipping service to other countries. So the people in the other country, they also get the milk that is produced in our country through the using the export service. And at the same time, the milk that is produced in this dairy farm is also transported to the processing center. That is a firm, or I may say a factory, where the packaging is done. So what basically the point is, this dairy firm is using the service, transport service, to bring the milk that is produced here to the processing firm or this. So there are many people who are earning their life by working in the dairy firm, and at the same time there are again many people who are working in this processing firm who are earning their life by doing some economic activity. This processed milk is further brought to the distribution center using a transport service. Distribution center, and from this distribution center, it may that the milk is transported to the restaurant, and from the restaurant, the cook is using that milk to produce final good that is being served to the guest. Similarly, from the distribution center, the milk is also coming to the retail shop, and from the retail shop, we are buying the milk and we are using the milk as a final consumer. So this is what actually. So the point is, here you can see that each and every person, one way or other, helping each other to run the economy, or they have their own role to play in an economy. So this system of cooperation among the people is nothing but it is actually called an economy. So here we can see that we are using the dairy farm to produce milk, then transportation service like shipping service, or I may say that is your transportation service like road service is being used to transport the milk from one center to the another center. Then it is being that milk is used in a restaurant, that is an example of a service sector, and that is being served to the guest, that is the guest, those who come to the restaurant. So that this shows a system of cooperation. So economy can also be defined as a system of cooperation. I hope now you have understood actually what a system of cooperation means. Okay, let me go to the next slide where I will show you the second point, which actually we have seen in our first slide, that it is economy can also be defined as a system of mutual exchange. So let's see what actually the word mutual exchange means, and I hope you will be finding it interesting to see that the two pictures that I have drawn here, the two pictures that I have shown here. So you can okay, we'll go through this picture, but before that, let us first go through the point to understand what actually a system of mutual exchange means. You can see, a man cannot produce everything that he wants, therefore he has to depend on others to meet his want. Such an economy is called barter economy. In modern economy of today, goods and services are exchanged through the medium of money. So these are the three points that will help us to understand what actually a system of mutual exchange means. To be very practical, if we talk about, say, barter economy is nothing but, I'll give you a small idea. In early days, when there was no concept of money, in today's time, what happened when we want something, we go to the market, we give the money and we take the commodity from them. But in when I'm talking about, say, 200 or 300 years back, or if we are talking about, say, the time when the early men, or I may say that is, those tribal peoples used to live, that time there was no concept of money. So whatever they used to produce, they used to exchange among them according to their need. So as you can see a picture here, this is what actually barter economy means. He is a one person who is having fish, and there is another person who is having a wheel. So, and both of them want to, say, suppose both of them want to exchange. So he is going to give a wheel, and in return of that wheel, he is going to give a fish. So that is what called exchange. So in early days, the people used to exchange by giving one commodity against the another commodity. This system of exchange, where one commodity was exchanged with the another commodity, that system has been given a name called barter economy. We used to say that we have given a name a barter economy. Here you can see one small picture again, that this person is telling that no thanks. He want to give a wheel, but they are very busy, and they are saying that no need, I don't want a wheel. So that was a very important problem in the barter economy. That means the commodity that one I produce, it may not be accepted by the other person, or he may not be in a need of that commodity. So that was a little bit problem in the barter economy, that there was a lack of double coincidence of want. That means what I want to buy, maybe the person who is there, he is not ready to buy that commodity. So that is okay. That is what a problem of the barter economy. But you can see here, we also say it mutual of exchange, system of mutual exchange, because the meaning of this exchange has changed now. In today's economy, we do not have to give one commodity to have another commodity. What we need, that we need to give money. So when we give money to one person, he give the commodity to us, and then he use that money to buy the commodity which he desire or which he wants. So that is how the entire economy works. So some economists suggest that economy can be defined as a system of mutual exchange, that is exchange among the people. So this is what the word economy means. I hope you have you remember what I told just now. So just let us quickly see what are the things we have seen. So first thing that we have seen is the definition of economy. This is a general definition where the people get getting their living directly or indirectly. And there are two more definitions, that is a system of cooperation and system of mutual exchange. Okay, so I'll move on further to make you understand what actually the word entity means here. I hope you remember the first slide that shows the title of this chapter, that economy and entity, and then we'll move on to understand some more concept in this chapter. So you can see here, people or institution that perform economic activities such as production, consumption, distribution, etc. is called an entity. Okay. To be simple, so I'm not going for the bookish definition. To be simple, I just want to say the people, those who are there in the economy, or the people, those who are living in our country, if I ask you to group or to divide these people under certain groups, then you are going to find that there are some people who are producers. There are some people who are producing something or other. So they come into a group of producer. There are some people who are consumers, who demand the commodity in the market and who are consuming. So we can group some people into a category of consumer. But at the same time, there are some people who are working in the administration to look after the peace and the order in the country. And at the same time, they are looking to maintain the economic stability in the country. So they are basically grouped under the third heading, and that is called government. That is called government. So if I am going to classify the peoples, those who are in our country and those who are working, you can find there are some people, those who are producer, and they can be called as they work in a farm to produce commodity. There are some people who are consumers. They are called consumers, or sometimes we say household. We use this word consumer and household simultaneously, but I'll let you understand what is the basic difference between the word consumer and household afterward, right? And the third category is government. So there are three entities that we are talking about. One is consumer, One group of people is consumer, another group of people is producer, and the third group of people is government. So these three group of people is nothing but what we have given it them a general name called entities. So for a systematic study, we classify these entity into four important groups, and I hope now you have understood what is the meaning of the word entity. So let us further see what is there in this chapter, what is next in their chapter. So you can see here their work again, the classification of economy, that is your some people are there who are doing productive activity, that is they comes under production. There are some who are consuming, so there comes they are doing consumption activity. Government is the third important economic entity, who are playing two role, that is they are producing also, and at the same time they are consuming also. I'll let you know why I'm saying that they are producing, because it is not that they are only at looking after the peace and order in the country, but at the same time they are providing with some general services like education, road transportation service and many thing, and at the same time they are consumer, because they buy different commodities or the product from different countries, and at the same time they buy the goods from the factories of our country also. So in that sense they are consumer, and when they are providing education services or road services or something like this, they are producer also. So government play both the role. And we have one more entity here, but this is not in our syllabus, so we'll not go much into it detail. I'll just let you know that external economy, that is also one important entity, that is outside the country. For India, it may be that external economy can be US economy, Australian economy, or European economy, or many Chinese economy, from which we are doing export and import businesses. So there are four important entities in our economy. So okay, let's see what is there next. You can see here a small small figure that is going to explain us the relation between these entity. As I told, again I am telling this, that there are three important entities we are going to discuss in our syllabus, and that is consumer or household, next is your firm or producer, and third is government. So you can see here, this is actually a picture of a house that represent consumer, or that represent household individuals. This is a picture of a parliament that represent government here, and this is a picture of a factory that represent businesses, that is the producer side. What we are going to do here, we are going to understand with the help of this small picture that how these three entities are related to each other. What is the relation between them? So if I start here, then you're going to find that the upper part is representing resource market, a market where resources is sold or purchased, whereas the downward part is representing product market, where goods are sold and purchases. Resource, what is actually a resource means? Resource means nothing, but resource means the human skill and the knowledge. So it is not that we are not trying to say that the human being are sold and purchased. It is the service of the human being that is sold and purchased. So a teacher is not sold or purchased. It is the service of the teacher that is sold and purchased. And that is, that market is called resource market, or sometimes we have given it a special name called factor market. So factor market or resource market is that market where the service of human being are sold and purchased, right? And of course, so I may also say like this, that it is not the police whom we are selling and purchase, it is the service of the policeman whom actually what that is being sold and purchased in the factor market. And similarly, if you look into the product market, then product market is nothing but it is the market where goods, commodities are sold and purchased, that is the commodity which we generally go to the market and buy. It can be a mobile phone, it can be a laptop, it can be a television, it can be a refrigerator, it can be groceries item. So that is that, all these are actually called commodities, that is tangible in nature, which we can see and at the same time which we can touch. So these are the two different types of market, and with the and within these two market, these three entities are related. How they are related, what actually the idea is? The idea is, you can see here the arrow mark that is pointed towards resource market. So from the consumer side, it is us who are providing our services to the resource market, and it is the factory or the firm who are hiring us for the service. So many of your parents are there who are working in factories, who are doing their job. So they are actually giving their services to factory and firm. they are giving their services to the service sector. So we are providing our service to the service sector. And in return of the service that we are providing to the businesses, they are paying us money. So that is what actually the arrow mark is being shown here. So basically, when we are providing the service from house to the firm, in return, they are providing us money for our service. Understood? Now, the point is, the service that these firms are using, our service which these firms are using this service, they are generating commodities. They are generating goods. So it is us who are working in the firm and helping the firm to produce mobile phone, televisions, laptops, and the other commodities like this. These commodities are brought to the product market, maybe it a retail shop, mall, or the places where the commodity goods and services are sold. So basically the goods and service are sold here. And this goods is something that is being brought to us. So the good that is produced in the business is actually brought by us for our consumption. And when we are buying those goods, in return of that, we are paying the money to the business firm. So this is, see, there is a circular flow. So we are providing the service, in return, they are providing us money. We are using that money and we are giving that money to the business firm and they are providing us with goods. So there is a kind of a circular relation between firm and household. Okay, so let me bring the third economic entity, then you can understand what actually the role of the government is. So if you look into the third entity, that is government, then it is the household who are paying taxes to the government. So we are paying tax to the government, and in return, the tax that the government is collecting from us, the government is using that tax for the welfare of us. For the welfare means they are providing us some public goods with the tax that we are paying. Public goods means we can talk about like this. Say suppose in the street, when we walk, we find that the street lights are there to help us out. When we go out during the night also, the street lights are there and we feel comfortable and safe. So these are type of public services. Like education, the education that the government is providing through their schools is also a kind of the public good that they are providing us. And at the same time, they are also providing us transfer payment. So transfer payment is nothing but examples of transfer payment can be unemployment allowances. That means some peoples are there who are actually they don't have any work to do, so for them to survive their life, some amount of money is paid to them. That is called unemployment allowances. Like old age pension, that is again another type of transfer payment. Old age pension is nothing but those people who cannot fulfill their demand and who are unable to work after the age of 60, they cannot work, and therefore some amount of money is being given from the government so that they can survive their life. So that comes under transfer payment. So the money that we pay to the government is returned to us in the form of public good and transfer payment. Similarly, it is the business who are also paying the tax to the government. The government is paying businesses are paying tax to the government, and in return, the government is also providing them some public goods and subsidies. Subsidies like, say suppose production of some goods which are helpful for the entire society. So if the price of that good is too high in the market, then some amount of money is paid from the government side to the business firm so that the price can be brought down and the people like us, that is the general people like us, can buy those commodity. A best example of subsidy that we know is the subsidy that is given in a LPG cylinder. So this is how actually the three important entities are related to each other. So you can see here, and at the same time, the government buy the service of the people. There are many people in our economy who work as a government employee. And the government is using the service from the resource market. You can see here the downward arrow represent this, and the service that the government is using from us, they are paying the money to us. That is what actually the dollar sign represent here. So the money is being paid to the government employees, those who are working for the government. And at the same time, you can see here the goods, the government also buy the goods from the product market, and in return of the goods that they buy, they pay the money for it. So for running the government institution and organization, they also need commodities, and hence they buy the commodities from the product market and they give the money in return. done to that. So this is a picture that I may say that explain the relation between the three entities of our economy. I hope you have now understood that how the three entities are related to each other. So let me see what is there in the next slide, if I can help you out to make you understand. So you know, the word is now, I think the word is now familiar to you, where you have understood who are called consumers. So consumers are the decision maker in the society. They take the decision, they buy the goods and the service and to satisfy their wants. So whatever as a consumer I need, I'll go to the market to buy that commodity so that I can get a satisfaction from it. And you can see examples, a consumer take decision to allocate his income in manner to have food consumption, education, entertainment, and many things. We have a lot of wants. And this is what actually I explained in my first two video, where I told that human wants are unlimited. Do you remember in the scarcity definition where Mr. Robinson was telling that human wants are unlimited, our one want is satisfy another want come up. So you can see here, that is what the same thing is told, that we allocate the money income that we earn in order to have each and every commodity that of our needs. Sometimes we spend money to have food, we spend money to have education, we spend money to have entertainment. So this is how actually this is what the role of the consumer. So this okay, I'll go for the last slide. And then in some more videos, I will explain this chapter. But for today, this is our last slide, where I will explain you the importance of consumer and their role. I can understand some of you will are wondering that why I have given this picture. You can see the picture here. So you may be wondering that why suddenly I have given a picture from Avengers, one of a very famous Hollywood movie, where you find all superheroes are here. Let me see how many of them I can name. This is a Hulk. This is Captain America. This is Thor. This is Iron Man, Spider-Man, Doctor Strange. And I don't know the name of these two person. You may be knowing this, but I'll let you know that why this picture is being given here. For this, we have to go through these 3 points. So, okay, let's see what is the first important role of the consumer. As you can see here, it is written, they are the source of demand for goods and goods in the economy. As you know that consumers are the biggest source of demand for various goods in the economy. The greater the demand, larger will be the production of good. The point is, it is us who demand. And by understanding our demand, the producers in the economy produces good. So they do not want to produce. The producers do not produce any good which the consumers do not like, because it is not going to generate a profit for them. So it is us who demand the good, and on the basis of that demand, the commodities are produced by the producer. So I can say in a simple term that one of the importance of consumer is that they demand the commodity. They are the source of demand from where the demand generate. And of course, if I go for the second point, the point tell that they are the source of diversification in the economy also. This is a very important point. Diversification means each and every consumer have different tastes and preferences. We all have a different taste and preferences. If I take the examples, as you can see here, if I talk about, say, suppose these superheroes, then it may happen that some of you may tell that Iron Man is your favorite. Some of you may tell that no, Spider-Man is your favorite. So, for some, Captain America is a favorite. For some, it is Hulk is a favorite. Doctor Strange is a favorite. So the point is, all of them are superheroes, and they are actually expert with their skills. But the point is, our preferences are different. So some for some it is someone is a hero, for some someone is better than this. So basically the point is, diversification is there in the economy because consumer tastes are different, and this is the result that why we see varieties of good that is produced in our economy. So let me come to the economical part again. If I talk about, say, toothpaste, let us talk about toothpaste. So we all know that toothpaste is used for brushing. We do not use toothpaste as a cosmetics. We do not put it on our face so that our face can also glow. So the point is, toothpaste is used for brushing, but the thing is that each and every consumer have a different taste and preference for the toothpaste that is available in the market. some of us like Colgate, some of us like Pepsodent, some of us like Patanjali. So basically the point is these varieties of toothpaste is being produced by the producer. It only because it is us who are demanding these commodity. It is us, it is our taste and preference. And because of this, actually, we can find the producers are producing varieties of commodities. Like, for example, we can also talk about automobiles, like car. We have a different taste and preference. Some of us like the car that is a Toyota car. Some of us like Hyundai. Some of us like Honda. So there is a difference in the taste and preference. And this is the reason that why we see that automobile sector is producing varieties of car in the economy, right? I hope you have understood that consumer is a source of diversification in the economy. Diversification means varieties, right? And finally, coming on to the third point, you can see we consumers are also the source of service in the economy. In the first point, I told they are the source of goods, and now I'm saying that they are the source of service. Service means we are not just satisfied with the goods or the commodity that is produced, but at the same time, we demand service. Service of a doctor, service of a teacher, service of a banker. Like this, there are various people whose service we need. So when we want to save our money, we go to the bank and we take the service of a banker. When we are fall, we go to the doctor and we take the service of a doctor. When we want knowledge, we go to the teachers and we take the service of a teacher. So it is not that we are only demanding goods in the economy, but as a consumer, we are the source of services in the economy. So these 3 points explain very clearly that what is the importance of consumer in the economy. So first importance is they are the source of good, they are the source of diversification, and they are the source of demand for service in the economy. So I hope you will like this video, and expecting to make some more videos on this chapter so that we can go through some more topics in this chapter that is interesting for us. Just I'll show you the slide. So this is household. We are going to understand what is household, importance of household, and like producers and importance of producers, government, and many things. Okay, so thank you. So you all go through this video, and I will be giving you some more videos on this chapter. Thank you.